You're listening to Thunder Quack Podcast Network.
To the Thunderquack podcast, enough said, for our review of Marvel Studios Eternals. There's no the, by the way, you guys. There's no the. It's just Eternals. I am one of your hosts, Michael Cohen, alongside the astonishing Amanda Konkin and spectacular Kurtis Finley. How's it going, guys?
Doing good, doing good. Excited to talk about this movie, although not as excited as I was hoping that I would be to talk about this movie.
That's I'm still fair. Getting over the fact that it's called Eternals and not The Eternals. That was definitely
it's a shocker,
that
right?
My whole life has been a lie this last week.
So they when they announced it, it was The Eternals, and then at some point, like I think about a month or two ago, they dropped the from it, and it just became Marvel Studios Eternals.
It's The Eternals, just like it's The X-Men. Right, the movie's just called X-Men.
Did I definitely tweet the wrong account this whole time that I've been tweeting at The Eternals? There's definitely a The Eternals account. Yep, 100%. That's what happened. Yep.
And it's not the official account.
So upsetting.
So you've just been tweeting. I have willy nilly at
really like just at The Eternals. I'm so professional.
Unbelievable.
Awesome.
We're a little bit out of order, right? I mean, we talked about this on the last episode when we did What If, but we just kind of never did a Shang-Chi review. It just never happened. It didn't coalesce. So we're doing Eternals now, but our next one will be for Shang-Chi, and then after that will be Spider-Man No Way Home, right? I don't remember which comes first. We gotta look at that.
Whichever one comes first, we'll do next.
Yeah. But for this episode, we are going to be talking about Eternals. The 26th feature film in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, released on November 5th, 2021, in actual real-life movie theaters. produced by Kevin Feige and Nate Moore, executive producers Victoria Alonso, Luis D'Esposito, Kevin Delanoy, directed by Chloe Zhao, with screenplay by Chloe Zhao, Patrick Burleigh, I guess. I don't know. I'm going to guess. Ryan Firpo and Kaz Firpo, and screen story by Ryan Firpo and Kaz Firpo. Kurtis, what does screen story by mean?
Well, let me tell you, screen story credit is given when a screenplay is based on source material, but the screenplay story is new and substantially different from the source's material.
So the distinction, the interesting distinction there is that a lot of the other ones are, it's story by, but this one is screen story by, which was the first time that I had seen that. So
and this makes a lot of sense to me because the Iron Man, for instance, the Iron Man movie is a pretty much a beat by beat retelling of Iron Man's origin story.
Yeah.
But this Eternals is nothing like the comic Eternals. I mean, there's similarities, but it's very, very different.
It's based from scene one, it's basically like off track into new stuff. But Music by Ramin Djawadi, who people would be familiar with from Game of Thrones. Actually, he also did the score, I think, for the first Iron Man. So, not really? His first MCU.
Marvel
yeah.
Deep Cut.
Yeah, and starring Gemma Chan as Cersei, Richard Madden as Icarus, Angelina Jolie as Thena, Salma Hayek as Ajak, Kit Harington as Dane Whitman, Kumail Nanjiani as Kingo, Leah McHugh as Sprite, Brian Tyree Henry as Fastos. They pronounce it like three different ways in the movie. Lauren Ridloff as Makari, Barry is this Keegan or Kogan? Amanda, you would know.
Yes. Well, you would think. I should Google how you say his name.
Okay, well,
like,
whatever.
It's one of those. I feel like
it's one of those. As Druig, better Ezra Miller as Druig. Don Lee as Gilgamesh. Harish Patel as Karun. I'll save that for our MVP section. And Bill Skarsgård as Crow.
We're all going to have the same MVP again.
Such a ridiculous cast. But hey, what a ridiculous cast. Amazing. Don't worry. Several of these people are going to be dead after about 15 minutes of screen time. So granted the movie will feel like it's about 4 hours long. So 15 minutes of screen time feels like about half of the movie.
That's fair.
Time has no meaning in this film. It just has no meaning.
And also death has no meaning because as we find out very spoilerifically, which I think if everybody's listening to this podcast, you understand.
But you better know that we're going to spoil it.
They could bring everybody back.
Yeah.
Because they like all they need is their memories. And I feel like those are downloadable. If they save the hard drive properly, I feel like the Celestials could bring them back. I just would be really sad if there was another movie without Don Lee in it. Because he's great.
I agree. Let's get into our overall thoughts. Amanda, you kick us off.
This is my overall thoughts for this movie are that I went into it knowing people were like, you know, are you looking at the reviews? And I'm like, no, I'm going to go enjoy myself a Marvel movie because I would like to see it. And the cast is spectacular. And I always like Marvel movies. And it was true. I came out of the movie knowing the flaws. Like you watch it and you're like, oh, there's, yep, mm-hmm, this, yep. However, I was spectacularly impressed by, I knew that I was going to like Kingo going into the movie because I like Kumail Nanjiani. He's like, great. But I thought that I was going to hate Druig. And he's like, him and Makari's relationship in the film was like amazing and incredible and just so unexpected. And I love it when you can put little pockets of character building in stuff. And I will say, I know that they tried really hard. There's too many characters in this. And I think that a lot of the stories that could have been really well developed and the journeys for characters got a little bit underserved. But that relationship worked because it was so sort of out of left field, and the little bits that we got were just like they were comedic and genuine, and it was just so unexpected for me to come around away from the. So I didn't like what I thought I would like about the movie, and my overall thoughts are that I like Chloe Zhao's work, and I think that what she does really well is like that human like character building and the really human moments, and I think that that relationship is so unique to this particular film that it feels like she is a huge like part of building that, which I think is really was really great. And in everything else that all the magic and all of the like everybody else's storylines that are reliant on other things, there's just something kind of interesting to see the core of how she's getting at storytelling and like character building that I think if this was a miniseries would have been maybe much more apparent with some of the other characters as well. Because I've seen it twice because I did wind up taking somebody else next yesterday because I was like, oh, we're podcasting about it. I'm going to go watch it a second time. And I did take a bathroom break the first time I watched it when they were on the plane and Kingo had his first little moment with Sprite. And so I had missed that the first time around. And so my first understanding of their relationship came when he was like making fun of her creeping on Icarus in the forest, and I was like, that came out of left field. But then having watched it and been like, oh no, they touched base like three times through the movies, and there's sort of those like that nice relationship between the two of them as well. It made me realize that they really do, if you like on the second watch, they do really try to get these really unique character moments all the way through with different relationships. But my biggest thing in this, I want to know your guys' thoughts, because my biggest overall thought is that I really am frustrated by Icarus and Dane both being love interests for Cersei. I think it muddied it up for me, because I didn't know why I was supposed to care about Icarus when I already cared about Dane. And then I'm like, also, I don't really care about either. Like, Richard Madden is so milquetoast. I don't know. He just I'm like, oh, cool, you're Icarus. I guess I should care about you. But I just didn't. And so then when he turns, I'm like, meh, you're the worst anyways. So that's fine. Anyways, those are my overall thoughts are that I think that I'm excited to see what they do with Dane Whitman. But I don't know if this was necessarily the right place, because I think he distracted a little bit from what could have been a really interesting development between Cersei and Icarus.
Yeah.
And I think that I miss that. So again, just I'm focusing on the characters in this, because the movie, you don't know what's going on in the movie until an hour into it. We've talked about this before, Mike. It's the, what is it? Jupiter Ascending paradox, where you're like, why does Jupiter Ascending suck? And it's because you don't know what that movie's about until an hour into it. I do feel like I got a little bit of that tonally in this movie. So what I did latch onto, and the thing that I could relate to, is the characters, because there's so many of them, and the acting is so, like, I love those actors, and I think that there's something in each of the roles that they brought to it. So I tend to focus on those positive lights, and that's my overall thoughts, is that while there are some flaws in this movie, I am joyfully optimistic because it is Marvel, and I let it get a pass in many ways. So
yeah, Kurtis, how about you?
Well, I agree with Amanda in that these characters are great. I thought that the casting here is absolutely fantastic. The updates and changes that they made to a lot of these characters are really, really fresh and new and exciting, and I'm happy that they did it. What I don't like about this movie is that it's the whole screen story thing here. It's like, if they had stuck to the original concept of the Eternals, I think that we would have had a much more interesting movie. They treated these guys like space gods when they're not space gods. The Celestials are the space gods. The purpose of the Eternals is that the Celestials created humans and Eternals and Deviants all to live on Earth together, and they totally ruin that here. They turned the Deviants into mindless monsters when they're supposed to be a very intelligent race. But they're just a warring race, whereas the Eternals are the peaceful race, and that's where we get the conflict. It's like if they rebooted Star Wars, and turned all of the Sith Lords into mindless zombies. It's like, that's not interesting. Wait. This is not an interesting movie anymore. So I was surprised that they went in that direction, because we have movies already where it's just the bad guys facing monsters. It's not exciting. It's boring. So that's kind of how this movie came off, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with both of you guys. I think you've both made a lot of the points that I would make. I do think that the biggest thing that this movie suffers from is the lack of a coherent nemesis, which,
yeah,
that's ultimately, I think, what these movies live and die by. When we think about the best MCU entries, oftentimes one of the reasons that they're at their best is because they have a phenomenal villain, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Black Panther, yeah. Shang-Chi, Infinity War and Endgame, right? Like, and then we think about the ones that are weak, Thor: The Dark World, right?
Who even remembers that guy's name? No, and like the same with this one. Like the main deviant who, you know, he gets his human form back, they never once say his name. His name is Crow.
I didn't know that. I saw you guys write it on this sheet that we're like, I was like, oh,
he is one of the most prominent deviants in the comics, and we're not going to give him a name in the movie. He also has a huge romantic relationship with Thina, and they are kind of going to toss that aside, I think.
So I think one of the things that will become more clear as time goes on is how much of this movie is actually just set up for other stories.
Yeah. And that's I think too.
If you've watched the Disney Plus Day Marvel and the MCU 2021 reel that they put together, there are some sneak peeks at stuff that's coming next year. And one of those things is Ms. Marvel. And Ms. Marvel appears to have a slightly different power set than we're used to with her. This is more than likely because of the fact that we tried Inhumans on ABC. It did not go. And so now it's like, okay, well, we're not going to talk about Inhumans. We're not going to talk about Terrigen Mist. We're not going to talk about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Or any of that stuff. Because it's just muddy, right? Like I think they want to keep that separate. And I do anticipate that Ms. Marvel will be connected in some way to the Celestials and Eternals. That's something that they're going to set up. I was super disappointed because I really thought that we were going to start to get our hints at the mutants that the convergence and the Infinity Stones and stuff like that. I mean, like my theory of it's not off the table, right?
Yep.
But I just thought that we were going to get at least one concrete piece of evidence to point us in that direction. And instead, this movie felt like it was the opposite. It felt like it was almost working really hard to disconnect itself from the rest of the MCU story because they needed to make the excuse of, oh, well, the Eternals couldn't help. And to me, like I was very satisfied with what we got in the trailers we were told not to. Right. Like we have a mission and that wasn't part of our mission. But the movie repeatedly is like, by the way, you can't interfere. You guys. Hey, guys, don't interfere. Hey, guys. Icarus and Circe are holding hands again. Remember that because it's important, because nothing about the actual performances or chemistry is going to let you know that these two are in love.
Oh,
but don't worry.
So
we're going to remind you every 15 minutes with another flashback of them holding hands. So don't worry about that. But guys, don't interfere. Okay. And it's like, all you needed to do was say it once and move on from it. And it's like, okay, you're telling us that they weren't allowed to interfere. That's why they weren't part of Infinity War and Endgame. That's why they weren't part of the first Avengers, right? Whatever. You don't need to keep relitigating it every half an hour in the movie, every time we introduce another character. Yeah, I know. And that's why we couldn't interfere. They also spent a lot of time reintroducing the problem every time they picked up a new character. It was just there's a right way and a wrong way to do the building a team or like getting the team back together. And I feel like this should have been constructed a little bit more like a heist and a little bit less like a 1960s, 1970s epic, because it tries to do that. Like it tries to have like that Ten Commandments, Ben-Hur, sort of like, wow, look at the grandeur and scope of this story. And it's like, well, I mean, like, you guys know that these stories take place in a cinematic universe that is literally a universe. Like we as an audience know that while this is happening, the Guardians are off somewhere doing something crazy, and Thor is off somewhere doing something crazy, and characters that haven't been introduced yet, but we know are coming, like the Silver Surfer and Galactus, are off doing something crazy. Like we know that it's the Marvel universe. You don't like it, it the grandeur and scope is actually like baked in. You don't need to go out of your way. But I feel like the movie spent a lot of time going out of its way to be like, can you believe it? 7,000 years, you guys. They've been on this planet for 7,000 years. And it's like, yeah, it's also the approximate runtime of the film. So we get it. Like they really put you through that in real time. Yeah, I would have really liked it if they would have just started on it. No stupid, half-baked Star Wars crawl at the beginning. That really annoyed me. you either do it or don't do it, right? Like either that text is moving or it's not.
Any information. It didn't give you any information that you don't discover throughout the movie. Like
exactly. Start on the flashback of them arriving on Earth. I don't need to know the where they came from stuff or whatever. And this is obviously gonna just be me personally. I know that a lot of the audience probably needs these cues and stuff, but it's like, I don't need to know that, you know, like we don't need like a 10 minute thing of the Celestials setting them up and whatever, and sending them out and whatever. And then, you know, half an hour of them getting to Earth and not interfering by completely interfering, and introducing a MacGuffin dagger that has nothing to do with the plot and never comes back. Such a weird choice. Just like,
I don't remember that. What was that?
She picks up the dagger and metamorphoses it into that thing.
Oh yeah.
And then we cut to it like on the screen in I don't know.
And it's an ancient artifact in a museum.
I do understand. Again, I watched it a second time, and the purpose of that is to show how they did help intelligent life evolve.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Like in terms of like, I understand why, but again, because they hammer you over the head with it like four times.
But we're gonna get a scene an hour later in the movie where Phaistos is like, exactly. Hey, yeah, check this out. I call it the steam engine, and it's like, what do you mean you call it the steam engine? You guys came here on a spaceship. You came here on a spaceship that is so advanced it just looks like Googas and Zimzams flipping around in circles.
Yeah.
Like it makes no logical sense, and it doesn't need to. Like I'm not saying like, oh, we need to see the mechanics of their ship. But it's like, but you guys, your science is so advanced. I don't understand why one of your characters is inventing things.
But he had to purposely think, how can I make this as rudimentary as possible?
Yeah.
So that these peons on Earth can understand
such
it.
It's such a weirdly unnecessary... like so many of the flashback moments, they're like these weirdly unnecessary explained things of like, this is why we're here, you guys. And it's like, I don't know, it just...
It's also explaining what their characters do for people that don't quite catch on to all the stuff that they're doing throughout the movie, which I think is a little bit like that, because you can tell if somebody doesn't understand that he's
I would have constructed it a little bit more like a Star Trek crew. Of like everybody has their like you're like the chief science officer, you're the medical, you're this, you're that, you're the captain, you're blah, right? Like to make it a little bit easier to just like have a shorthand and understand that like, oh, they're a spaceship crew that comes to a planet where there's deviants. They kill all of the deviants, but they all have their specializations. But eventually we get to the part where it's like, well, you're manufactured, and so they're all manufactured to do different things and have different powers or whatever. But it was just there was just a little bit too much of all of that stuff that for me got in the way of what was important about the movie, which was the characters, which is the part that like, because I know I'm being really negative and I'm yucking it up a little bit. I am playing these things up for jokes, but. I do actually love several of these characters. Unfortunately, I think my favorite one, like Gilgamesh dies. So it's like, I'm glad I invested in him for the 10 minutes that we get to see him on screen so that he could die. And yeah, I thought like that, like it's just, it's that stuff. It's those aspects of it. This was a really, really good 2 or 3 season Disney Plus show that they decided to make a movie out of.
They make a movie. And that's 100%, 100% what it is. Because what you're talking about there is like the opening scene didn't even do what it was supposed to do. Like you're supposed to have a real good action scene, but it's supposed to tell you the core of each of the characters. And the problem is they can only include the fighting Eternals in those kinds of sequences. So you don't know what it is that Druig and Festus and Sprite and Cersei do, because you can't see them in the fight, and Ajak as well. Like you sort of get to see Ajak obviously fix Icarus, but like if you miss that in the opening sequence where you introduce the characters, you then have to shoehorn it in the ways that they did. So exactly what you're talking about, that scene with Festus, I think is because otherwise you don't understand what he does, because they didn't find a way to succinctly like tell you in the opening, in the opening bit.
Yeah.
Which is, and I love your analogy of the putting a heist together. That's so great, because it's, you're right. It's like they sort of didn't, because it's so epic in its grandeur, but you can't do that in a film because you did this whole like, let's show you how great they are and then also break them up and then also bring them back together.
Yeah.
But there were a lot.
Like the heist structure, and especially like Ocean's 11, I think is probably the easiest one to go back to, because it's so distilled, right?
Yeah.
Like it's right there. Everything that you need to know about it is very surface. So when they put the together the team, it's a montage, right? And it's like, and we're gonna need a guy that does this, and we're gonna need a guy that does this, and we're gonna need a guy that does this.
They're and all archetypes. Like,
Yeah, and I think that if you could have played into that a little bit more, and gotten the team back together a little bit faster, so that we could have had the dynamic, and I would have liked to have seen like everybody together at least once after they broke up, before we start killing people off, and we never really get that, right? So it's because we want to see. If you're going to show us both timelines, we want to see how they were when they were arrived, what happened to break them up, and then what they're how like they when together. They have to come back together now, 5,000 years later, and their personalities have shifted and changed, and their perspectives might be different with all of this new information, right? There are so many good ideas in the movie, and just not enough time. Despite the fact that it feels like there's so much going on, like there's not enough time to really explore any of these things to a satisfying degree.
But one of the things that you said though is that like you'd like to see where they started and where they ended. But I think that that's the crux of the matter, is that they don't actually shift from when you first meet them to the end. Like even their like quippy fighting style doesn't change. Like it's so consistent, and you don't see that growth of who it is. And
except for Festus.
Yes, 100%.
Yeah, but he's the only one.
Again,
though.
He's the only one that really like you sort of see that sort of go around. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
They tried to get you to see that in Sprite, but you really don't. Like it's tell you that's what Sprite goes through, but you don't see it.
There really needed to be a clearer line between the ones that embraced living amongst humans. And the ones who removed themselves from society, right?
Yeah.
Like, and the reasons why. I mean, like, I think that it's there, but I think that it's very subtextual, and it's not necessarily super thematically important to it. As a matter of fact, like thematically, what is the movie, right? Like beyond the actual mechanics of the plot, of obviously we don't want Tiamat to destroy the Earth. Right. Other and murder, you know, 7 billion people. You know, 3.5 billion of which just came back to life.
Bummer.
Like that, like all of that is very easy to understand, but beyond that, like for me, I think probably like discussing this now, like one of the biggest disconnects for me is the fact that like I really don't know what this is about. I don't know what anybody accomplished personally in terms of growth, other than learning to punch harder in their various different ways. Right. Like really at the end of the day, the thing that saves the day is that Cersei just punches harder with her ability to transform things. And there's no satisfying explanation for why she turns that deviant into a tree. it just happens because it was right. because yeah, it had to, because the plot dictated it. And like yeah. and it only happens there because it's a setup. Like it's a loop, right? Like why does she turn the deviant into a tree? Well, because if she doesn't turn the deviant into the tree, then she can't turn the celestial into stone at the end. So she needs to turn the deviant into the tree. But why did she turn the deviant into the tree? So that she can turn the celestial into stone at the end, right?
Like, this is an interesting thing too, because she's always been able to do that in the comics. The only yeah. reason why she couldn't do it at the beginning of this movie is because she could have taken care of this whole deviant situation many centuries yeah. ago.
And the movie absolutely gives you the mechanics to tell you why she can. Once she's got that little orb inside her, she's directly connected to Arishem and to the celestial power source. And it's like, that's all they needed to do. And it's like, that's where I get frustrated watching the movie, huh. is that there's so many of these points where it's like, well, obviously, that's what they should have done, which is always easy in hindsight. It's always easy for us to armchair quarterback it after the fact and go like, well, they obviously should have done this. When you're making a movie, there's a lot of moving pieces.
But maybe they did.
It's a wonder that it gets done in the first place. But it's also like Icarus flying into the sun at the end. And it's like, excuse me, super on the nose, guys, super on the nose. I know that we made the analogy of Superman earlier, but when he doesn't fly up into space and wink at the camera like Superman and then, you know, like fly off to save the world, which we love in the Christopher Reeve Superman movies. But it's like because he's actually a bad guy, it's sort of the negative turn on it. It's like he almost flies off into space and he's like mugging for us because like nobody else knows what he's doing. Right. Like he just kind of goes. And it's like it would have been so much more impactful. Amanda, I think, did we talk about this on Thunderquack last week? It would have been so much more impactful if the ending of that would have been like if he would have gone to Cersei and been like, I will not stop fighting. I can't stop fighting. It's the way that I'm built. It's what I'm supposed to do. You have to stop me.
And then right? to make her. Well, I mean,
and to make her
we
choose.
We did.
Right?
This is exactly what we talked about. Cause you can't yeah. make her into a bad guy by killing the person that she loves. It's a complicated, they sort of,
but I mean, I don't think you make her into a bad guy because first of all, they don't exist anyways. They're robots. It doesn't matter. Well, so yes. they don't have souls.
We understand the level of Marvel like storytelling and that you can kill. But I also mm-hmm. rewatched Shang-Chi recently, right? And it's a really fine line between what you're allowed to let your heroes do. Like you cannot let a bad guy not die at the end. Like if somebody does bad things and they don't die, there's a flaw in your story somewhere. And if you have a hero that kills somebody, you also can't have that. Like it's a problem that I have with like this Disney-ified storytelling and that we can't move beyond yeah. the binary black and white of hero and villain. And I think that this story would have been a perfect place to explore that. Like I would have really loved to dig into Cersei and Icarus, their love story and him and them just being on completely opposite sides of this. And then them both, because Icarus is not a bad guy if you look at it from the point of view of the Celestials, right? And they talk about that in the film, that it would just be kind of cool to also feel like, because it's not just Icarus, like Kingo also believes in what they're yeah. doing. Right. Which I think is a really interesting, like at the end, I think it's really, really important and interesting that it's Kingo, Phastos and Cersei that get to be judged on behalf of the humans. And I think that yeah. that's really like a really interesting like dynamic of the three that you could pick out that have the most varied experience. I just wish we got to sort of explore the nuance of that a little bit more. But anyways, I do think the Cersei Icarus, I'm excited to talk about our favorite moments because I do feel like some of our overall thoughts are really negative. But I do, I think there's a missed opportunity there in really exploring what you could have done with the like hero villain dynamic and then flipped it on its head depending on how you looked at it from like Celestials versus not. I don't yeah. know. Taking Selma Hayek out into a wasteland to have her killed by deviants is so pathetic. Like it's,
I was so unhappy.
Like, it's just so upsetting. Like make him stand up for his freaking beliefs in some way that is like, like if you have that sort of passion behind it, it's just so like he's just so pathetic.
But
and it's,
also and it makes it worse. Yeah. But also like, establish better in clearer terms that you have five Eternals that do not fight. Like, don't make it that like, oh, they're kind of tangentially involved in the fights. Make it really clear. These five are not combat, right?
Yeah.
And then make it super clear that it is the job of the other five to defend,
fight and protect them.
The other five from the deviants. Like that, not don't make them an extermination squad as much as make them like hey, you guys, you five are the guardians and these five are like the architects or whatever, right? Like mm-hmm. give it a really clear role, because then when he does that, if it was like
a betrayal,
Icarus,
and like your, like
your core purpose is actually to protect Ajak, but instead what you did was like, well, I am protecting Ajak because she's betrayed her own mission, right? Like, right, like, right, and have those things sort of like vocalized a little bit more. I don't know. I think that they said the wrong things and they showed the wrong things. Like it's almost like it needed to be flipped a little bit of like some of that stuff needed to be said a little bit more, and some of that stuff needed to be shown a little bit more, and sort of, you know, like sort of the show don't tell stuff, because sometimes it is good to have a nice expository, like, hey, here's an info dump of everything and the dynamic of everything that's involved, so that later on in the movie we can do something where it's like, because then Cersei fighting with her abilities becomes a triumph of her individuality, right? Like, right. And then, hey, guess what? Now the movie's about something. Now all of a sudden we have a theme, which is that like the 10 of them were created with a purpose, but what if they found their own purpose?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And within finding their own purpose, it turns out like, oh, actually, you know what? We're all built out of the same stuff, and our power source all comes from the same place. I can do anything that you guys can do, right? Like, to find out that like to have her do something like shoot one of the energy balls or something like that, and find out like, oh, actually they're all like, they've just been programmed to think I can only do this one thing, right? But it's actually all of you are Supermans, and
they can't.
Whatever,
no.
Right?
But they're not. Doesn't that, like, I don't know? Can't Kurtis speak up now? Aren't the Eternals? They are. They only have the powers that they have, don't they?
Yeah, but they change so much. But they change so much. Why not give it a reason?
Do they?
Yeah.
Do they?
Yeah. So the thing is that it's so first of all, Eternals is like a failed comic by Jack Kirby in the 70s, and he himself wasn't at the top of his game. Like, so Jack Kirby created like all of the Marvel universe, pretty much, like co-created, I should say, with Stan Lee, all of the major, most of the major characters. And then by the late 70s, when he was doing this one, he wasn't at the top of his game anymore. And so those, when he was creating these characters, he was like fast and loose with what powers they had. And it was like, sometimes it was like, oh, he forgets which character has which power, and so he lets that person do some weird thing, and you know, and every comic book writer that comes after that, of course, has to reconcile that because this is comics and everything has to fit into a neat box. So it's like, okay, now whenever there's a new Eternals series, all of the characters get reborn or resurrected or whatever, because they all died previously or whatever, and yes, they come back maybe looking a little different, they come back with new and improved or updated or different powers. So yeah, it is like, it could be whatever you want it to be, really.
Okay. That's cool though.
Yeah, it is. It's great.
Looking at it the way that Mike is talking about it too, like if that's the route that they wanted to go to be able to sort of speak to it more in terms of how they all relate to one another and their powers themselves. So.
Yeah, but I mean, each of them has their own ability and own special skill set, and that kind of stays constant throughout the whole thing. But yeah, if somebody needs to do something new or to develop in a different way, then they can.
To me, it would be similar in concept to like the Super Scroll, right? It's like, just because Cersei manages to do it doesn't mean that like now all of them are just gonna all be like that, right? But I think like for the story, and especially for her taking that central role, and again, the little orb goes into her, and you could just use that as your explanation why. And yeah. And instead of the bracelets and all of them using the Unimind, which doesn't really, they do and then they don't, and it's like, is Kingo, is his energy coming from his private jet, however far away he is?
Yeah.
How did he get, I don't, it's just like, yeah, there's a lot of that stuff.
Well, I thought
like,
he didn't do it because his bracelet was given to
But Icarus. It's not about the bracelets anymore. Isn't that, like, this is the most confusing part about the movie, is that it winds up not being about the bracelets, it winds up being about the Celestial, which is just completely bananas, because you set up this whole thing and then you wind up using it but not using it.
Yeah.
And you're like, what? How does that even?
Yeah. and to me, it's like that's where it's like, I say, like, that's where I get frustrated, is that there are all these things that it's like, it's just a little tweak, just this little piece. And it's like, you guys set this up over here and then you didn't pay it off over there. Right. Yeah. And so it's like their powers come from the Celestials. They're tapped directly into the Celestials. That's they say it several times in the movie. And then at the end of the movie, it's like, well, how does she manage to do it? Well, she turns the Celestial's power back on it. Right. It's like, that's awesome. So why did we spend 20 minutes of the movie with Fastos being like, hey, if we can just all connect our powers together because we're taking our powers from the Celestials? And it's like, actually, like, no, he should have been figuring out how do we take the channel, the power back out of Tiamat to stop Tiamat, right? Like, we have, like, there should have been like a eureka moment at some point where they're like, if only we could harness Arishem's power directly, and then for him to be like, we don't need Arishem, we've got a Celestial right underneath us, right? Like, there's a tighter, like, better movie that's only 2 hours inside this movie, and instead we got a 3-hour kind of bloated movie with a lot of very cinematic sweeping shots of things. And it's like, I don't want them to stop experimenting, and like, that's what this was an experiment. Let's do a different type of MCU film, and I'm glad that they did. It's not a bad movie by any stretch, it's just a flawed movie. It's not the Incredible Hulk or Thor: The Dark World, which are like, they're bad. Those are bad movies. Those are bad movies that do bad things and make bad choices.
Yeah, I just finished watching the Incredible Hulk, and it was a
bad movie that makes a lot of bad choices. Most of those Edward Norton's choices, and that's why he's not the Hulk anymore. But it's a perfect example of like, there is actually a great movie inside the Incredible Hulk, but unfortunately, somebody got in there and tried to make it something that it wasn't supposed to be, and ends up making it, you know, kind of boring and pointless by the end of it. Unfortunately, you know, not the best casting choices sort of across the board with that one, except for Tim Roth. So, I guess Thunderbolt, cause he's still with us as well. He's pretty cool.
Like half of the main cast was, well, because there's only you're just basically saying that they should have cast Betty in.
Well, yeah, okay, but that's from your perspective as someone who just watches the movies. But I think from Kurtis and I's perspective, knowing that like that there are like a few other Marvel characters in there that were meant to become other things, and it's
Google.
Okay.
I know that there's,
because like, I don't remember the actor's name,
the
but
doctor, dude.
Yeah, he's supposed to become the leader, and it's like, I don't want to see the movie where he's the antagonist.
I also don't want to see the movie where the guy from Modern Family is Doc Samson. Oh, I mean, not Doc Samson, but whatever his name is. Just
Yeah, exactly. So it's like that one suffers from the whole like, hey, we don't know what the MCU is. Yeah, as a matter of fact,
that's true. Yeah,
the Incredible Hulk was not part of the MCU. It was retconned into the MCU after Iron Man was a success.
That's right.
And they shot the scene after they locked, basically after Iron Man was finished, and like they knew this is going to be a big deal. Like, this movie is not, this isn't a movie. This is the beginning of something, right? They went and they shot the scene that's on the end of Incredible Hulk. So that wasn't ever part of the plan for the Incredible Hulk. The Incredible Hulk with Universal was its own thing. Universal had the rights. They were making a movie. And then Kevin Feige and Marvel Studios were like, and I think probably AVR had probably a big part of it as well, was like, can we shoot a scene with one of your characters and one of our characters? And then like, we'll be able to put these things together. Cause I think we're going to do this Avengers thing, right? Like they reverse engineered that. Anyways, we're not here to talk about the Incredible Hulk. So let's not go down that road. Maybe one day we'll get breathing room to go back and do old movies. I highly doubt it.
I don't think so.
Let's talk about favorite moments. Kurtis, why don't you start with your favorite moments from the movie?
Okay, I don't know that I have any one particular moment, but I do have two things I want to say. One is that I enjoyed every scene with Makari. I thought Lauren Ridloff is just amazing. I love her as an actress. I think in Walking Dead, she's absolutely fantastic as well. And so every time that she was there, I really, really enjoyed it. And they also showed her speed powers really, really effectively.
Yeah.
It was different than what we've seen in The Flash. It's different than like what we've seen with Quicksilver. It was nice and unique. And like that battle sequence when she's fighting Icarus on the beach was just absolutely so well choreographed.
Just to tag on to that, I think that the way that they showed super speed in this movie actually gave you a feeling of the velocity that she was moving at. It didn't feel like Quicksilver. It's like, oh, he doesn't actually move that fast. The world slows down around him.
Right.
And then like from our perspective, he's just a blur, but from his perspective, everything is frozen. Right. Or like the Flash in the DCEU movies, I don't even know what they're doing there. They just make everything blurry and he's in lightning and it's just like, okay, cool. I guess he's going really fast. But with this one, it's like, I would love to see, and I'm sure that when it hits Disney Plus, they'll probably put out the assembled like they did with Shang-Chi this last week. And I can't wait for that because I guarantee that they'll let us in on the secret of how they achieved that feeling. But they did, like, they really, really made you feel like she was moving that fast legitimately, like her body was able to move that fast.
And it was fantastic. It was
really, really well done, for sure.
The second thing I just want to point out is that I love the visual language that they developed in this movie to convey the Eternals' powers, using all of the thin lines and circles, the gold lines and circles. It is everywhere, and it's in every single one of their powers, and that brought a cohesiveness to the team that otherwise, if they hadn't done that, we would have just had, you know, nine different superheroes. But instead, we have a very tightly knit group of like a family of characters, all conveyed through these gold lines and circles. I really like that.
It's a bit like how when they did the 90s relaunch of the X-Men, all of a sudden everybody's abilities had that same magenta pink color to it, and they're all wearing blue and yellow, or blue yellow purple red across the team.
Right.
But it's like the Cyclops Optic Blast, Psylocke's
Psyblades.
Psyblades, Gambit's cards, Jubilee's explosion, like Jean Grey's abilities, like they all use the same sort of visual language. So you're like, oh, okay, cool. So that's what mutant powers look like, right?
Yeah.
Like that's exactly what the X gene does. It is very, very similar conceptually to that of like, yeah, these guys are all the same, right?
Yep, it was a brilliant move, and I'm glad that they did that. And there's a lot of visually really appealing stuff in this movie.
I will say that I don't think I have a favorite moment from this movie.
Whoa!
And I thought like that's kind of the hardest part for me.
That's sad.
Yeah, there are a lot of things that I liked about it, and I really like the characters. But I don't feel like any of them really got like a oh my god, that was incredible moment. Like everybody did something cool, but nobody ever did anything where I was like wow, that was one of the coolest things we've ever seen in the MCU. And it's we're a few weeks removed from it. Maybe if we were closer to it, I'd have a little bit more of that. But it's like I said, coming out of Black Widow, I was kind of eh. Coming out of Shang-Chi, I was like electric. Like I was like vibrating after that movie. It was so, so good. And we saw so many things. And it was like I just watched that a couple nights ago. And the end of that movie when he, I mean, I guess spoilers for Shang-Chi because this isn't the Shang-Chi episode, but when he shoots all the rings in and then he like moves them around and then pulls them apart with that move, like at the very end, and I'm trying to be a little bit vague, and then and then after that when they're retelling the story and she's like, yeah, and then Sean did he did like a Kamehameha thing and it was like he did do a Kamehameha thing, and it was like there. That's what I missed that moment in this movie. And I think the biggest reason why I missed that moment in this movie is because Kingo is the one that I wanted to like the most. And then
he leaves for the main battle.
he never got a hero moment, right? Like, yeah. I don't really feel like there was a thing where he did do a Kamehameha also, by the way.
I was going to say, didn't he do the ball thing and then the blast? Yeah.
But a bunch of them had moments where like they did something by themselves, and with him, it's like he did that and then it like slowed it down. Right. He didn't kill the wolf one with that. Right. Like he just slowed it down and then somebody, and then Icarus comes in.
No, doesn't he?
You've seen it twice. You know better.
I have seen it twice. And so here's the thing too. The Kingo and Sprite relationship gets paid off. Like there's three solid beats with them and they fight together. Like he's like, hold them off, Sprite. And then Sprite like uses her knife or whatever. And he does the thing and then he blasts it. And it's when all the goo falls on his face. And he's like, did you get that?
It's fun. And like I said, like everybody gets cool stuff to do.
But he didn't like save anybody dramatically or anything like that. He was just like with the guy fighting in the village. Like,
I guess if I have to pick a favorite moment, and I'm not saying like, oh, I guess I have to. It's just, this really sucks that the only moment in the movie that like got me to like perk up in my seat and get like legit excited about what I was seeing was one of the final shots of the film, which is like Cersei and Dane are hanging out, having their little conversation, and he's about to tell her whatever, and then we just get the rumble, and then That's the right. clouds part, and Arishem like, and it's just, it looked like legit and real, and it was like, hey. Humans, you remember when that Thanos guy showed up and it rocked everybody's world? Guess what? This is a bigger deal. This is a much bigger deal than Thanos. Like to me, it did for the movies what the Infinity Stone moment in Loki does for his character, where he's like, he looks around the TV and he goes, is this the greatest power in the universe? Right. And it's like, it's like, oh, you guys thought Infinity Stones and Thanos were a real problem. This guy, Arishem, he's one of the good ones. There is actually a bad one and he's going to want to come and eat the planet soon. So buckle up. And like, to me, it was so exciting because of what it was foreshadowing. Which is like, we're going to see that shot. We're going to see that shot again, only he's going to be purple and he's going to have a bib and a fork and knife because he's ready to chow down.
Wow. So what I liked about that scene also is that showed me that this next Eternals movie is going to be more in line with the concept of what the comics are going to be, because the whole point of the Celestials is that they are going to judge whether the planet is worthy of being saved. That's what they come over and over and over again to do. And they didn't do that in this movie, but they're going to do that in the next movie. And then if the Eternals and the Deviants can come together to try and stop the Celestial from passing its judgment, then that'll solve all my issues with the changes in all the source material.
But Crow got sliced and diced instead of what they should have done. Again, they were so close and just off the mark, because what should have happened there is it should have been like, oh wait, actually, you know, we're actually on the same side right now. We want the same thing. We want to stop this Celestial from being born. We have different reasons for it. We have different motivations, but we want the same thing. Come help us, right? Like that would have been so much more satisfying.
You thought that was going to happen when he arrives on the beach and then is fighting. They're all fighting Icarus. Yeah, and you're like, oh, totally. Look, he's going to fight with them. He sees that they're fighting Icarus. And then
it's such a wasted opportunity.
Okay. I wanted it to be that like Ajak gave him like sort of that spark of sentience.
But that
Gilgamesh gave him like a heart. Right. It was just one of those things where it was like, it felt like they had it and it, maybe it was in a different draft, but then like they cut it out of this one where it's like, well, he absorbed Ajak. And when he absorbs Ajak's abilities, it's not just his abilities, but also like her intelligence, her mind. Right. But then when he absorbs Gilgamesh, it's more than like, it's different because Gilgamesh is sort of leads with his heart and is this, he's the big one. He's the big brute, but he's also the softy, right? Making his pie and whatever, right? Like you get that feeling. Yeah. So it's like, it really would have worked for me if it would have been like, oh, actually, like more than just absorbing his superpower, it absorbed his emotional state as well. And so now he's sympathetic and he shows up and there's the whole like love thing between him and Thena. And it's like, there was an opportunity there. There was an opportunity for something really cool and for a certain subset of fans who really like it when pretty ladies make out with monsters to be satisfied as well. And I feel for those fans. That's not really my thing so much. Sometimes I enjoy it, but Gargoyles is a really good example. But
their relationship though is so interesting. Like Thena ends up spending more time
with the comics, right? Yeah.
Yeah. She spends so much time living amongst the Deviants because that's who she ends up relating to more. And that would be very, I was so disappointed that Angelina Jolie and Salma Hayek were so underused in this movie. Yeah.
Oh.
It's like these are two brilliant actresses and they are they're just pushed to the side the entire time. Yeah. I was like, why even bring them on board?
Why use them? Yeah, it's really brutal. It was probably something that was really a bummer. Yeah.
We're talking about favorite moments though, Amanda.
Favorite
moments.
Don't worry. I do have plenty of favorite moments and most of them involve Druig. And see, I feel like on a second watch, I didn't even realize, but okay, his leather jacket, one of my favorite moments. And then also I didn't catch this in the first one, but in my second watch through, because when they're in the Amazon and they're being attacked and he's got the, like all of the people have the guns and they're shooting and he's got them possessed, I didn't realize that it's him that comes in like with the no sleeve shirt on and like rolls over the Deviant and grabs a gun and like shoot. It's a great moment.
Yep.
But I didn't catch it the first time around because to be honest, I wasn't paying attention to Druig the first time I watched the film. I only started like really paying attention to Druig like after they get back, like just the like later, like halfway through the film. And then at the end, you're like, oh my gosh, this was such a great character arc. Which leads to my second favorite moment, which was I love the Miss Havisham reference, which was amazing when they come back to the Domo and Makari's like surrounded by the books, which is so great. But my absolute, like, I just think it's hilarious. The moment where they had played up that emerald tablet or whatever. And he's like, how'd you find this? And have their little like flirty flirt. That Kingo's like, I hate it. What is happening? I hate this because it's so, because he had all these like brilliant, like Kingo and Druig's relationship is so great because he also like is the same as everybody where he's like, Druig's the worst. Like when they go and like meet him and it's like, yeah, he is. But then you follow along and you're like, what is happening? Like why, what is this relationship that's happening in front of me? And it was fun. And then there's a little like, I don't know. Cause again, I was paying attention to these little moments, but he like hits her with a shoulder It's just like a cutaway that you're like, that was just a, such a cute little genuine moment that they kept in, of like that like flirting moment, which was cool. But then also that he doesn't die, which I think is kind of cool that he comes back around and he was doing the thing and they were going to actually, these Eternals that didn't have the powers were going to actually work. And I like that. I'm excited to see where it goes because it's him and Makari and Athena that go on the Domo. And I think that that's going to set up something kind of cool. I'll be intrigued to see what that dynamic is like, because Athena seems a little bit odd. But anyways, that was a fun moment for me. So that it was the Havisham and then the thanks, I hate it, or what is this, I hate it moment, which I think was really great. But you're right, Mike, and I'm kind of sad that the fighting moments, there wasn't anything, there's not that, because for me, in Shang-Chi, it really is the, like, you know the moment where he becomes Shang-Chi, right? Like, there's that moment where you're like, this is what it was all about. And unfortunately, with Cersei's character, I just didn't get that. And I know that you're supposed to kind of connect to her, but I think they just did her a disservice in setting her, because I also think, just so you know, we talked about this a little bit on Thunderquack. The reason I like Druig is not because of Druig, it's because of his relationship with Makari. I always think that heroes are more exciting to me based on how the others around them treat them and react to them and how they react to those people. And because Makari was so great and so strong and she connected to Druig, it made me automatically like Druig more, and it put more humanity on him and more sort of this character that was really, really interesting. Whereas with Cersei, because she had to play off of Icarus and Dane, I just never quite got, I don't think they did it a service where her love was sort of peripheral. Like, it wasn't what it was about. You didn't really, her chemistry with Icarus was garbage. Like, I didn't get that at all. But even her relationship with Sprite, you're supposed to see this journey of this girl that's so longing and so jealous and wants what Cersei has and can't have it. And she's everything. And I just didn't get that. You just sort of, because she didn't get to build these relationships quite as strongly with all these other people. And so I will say that I think was this is supposed to be favorite moments. It could have been a really cool moment in the very end, right? Yeah. where you have the, like, this is them, this is who they become. But Druig did sort of get that, right? Like, you have that moment where he's going to maybe be, like, he's connecting to the mind, and it would work if they didn't sabotage him and all that stuff. So that's all. Kingo and Druig, though, are what I liked. It was fun. I didn't talk about him, but I think we're not talking about him because we all agree that Phaestos is really awesome. His character arc is.
Yes.
Definitely. Yeah.
It's pretty great. And then Gilgamesh, obviously, with his pies and his cooking and his, his being a big old softy.
Spit beer.
He's great. Yeah.
His saliva beer.
Oh, yeah. That was great.
So such a good gag.
Yep. So good.
I think that it is an interesting thing, because I do think that a lot of my favorite moments in this movie are actually the comedic moments, and they're, it's within the pacing of it. I feel like those are paced really well, in the modern day stuff. But then whenever we flash back, it always feels like the we're missing a little bit of that. It always feels, because it's like, oh, now we're back in that epic movie thing. So it's a little bit more like self-serious, not entirely, but just a little, like the tone shifts a little bit. And that's probably why I connect a little bit more. And like, and one of my takeaways is, like, I really wish that they just did the one flashback at the beginning, like that they just got all of that out of the way. And then we got into present day and then just told our story in present day. I would be really interested to see a cut of this movie without,
that just does that.
The flashbacks that just tells the story chronologically in the present day, that just gives us a setup and then doesn't flashback in between, that just assumes that you know this stuff, right? Which they can't do for obvious reasons, but now that we've seen the movie, like, let's have this alternate cut, right? Because I think that I would enjoy that movie more.
Didn't have to care about Icarus and Cersei's relationship, you wouldn't have to do that.
Right. I think it's something that Marvel does often, is they'll take the unpopular characters, the unknown characters, and really give them a comedic bend in order to sell them to the audience. Because, like you said, Mike, anybody walking out of the theater will always remember the funniest bit of any movie.
Yeah.
And so we took Guardians of the Galaxy and Ant-Man, and turn them into funny movies. And even Thor became a funny character when they realized that serious Thor wasn't working. And Iron Man, when that movie came out, no one cared about Iron Man. And so they made him into a funny character as well. And they, I think that they were trying, they're trying so hard not to make these guys funny for some reason, which they really should have. And that's why Kingo is like the standout character out of all of them. And Karun, Kingo and Karun. Because they were the funniest. They're the ones I remember the most.
Yeah, I mean, so speaking of which, our MVP, I guess, Kurtis, it sounds like you and I are already in agreement.
Well, yeah, I might change mine because I want to add some variety, but I've already talked about Makari enough, so.
one of the characters that absolutely makes this movie for me is Karun. Played by Harish Patel.
It shouldn't work. But
it's
it does.
So dumb. Like it's so dumb.
So, yeah.
And yet, yeah. His moment at the end of the movie where he's crying and he's like,
thank you
for everything that you've done. And then he just like takes off or whatever, like he leaves.
Well, and yeah, he unexpectedly plays the Uncle Ben character as well, giving. Yeah. Wisdom at the right time and stuff. It's like it was weird, but it was great.
It's fantastic. I think a character that really kind of brings the whole thing together. But it just makes me want Kingo and Karun movies.
This is the great thing
about the MCU. This is the absolutely fantastic thing about the MCU. We can have a TV show that takes place before this movie.
Yeah.
That is the two of them.
Totally.
That's about him like making movies and stuff like that. And we can have like a smaller bad guy in there that like, something happened that he didn't talk about in the movie because it wasn't important at the time, but he absolutely like they're all heroes. So if something bad is happening, they're not going to just let it happen. Right. Or maybe it could be the story that tells us why he disconnected so much, right, from the rest of them. Like you could use it to tell that part of the story. So we could absolutely eventually get that stuff at some point.
I'd be
and that's
on board
the great thing
that.
About Disney Plus and all of that. So let's give us the 6-episode Kingo and Karun. I wish I knew off the top of my head that one of the names of his stupid movies. But
Warrior King, isn't it? Warrior King or something?
Something like that. Shadow Warrior.
Because that's what is throwing me off, because the Eternals has changed their Twitter to be like their like a Warrior King Stan account or something.
Oh.
Really? Oh, awesome. That's really cool.
The title's Shadow Warrior, sorry, Shadow Warrior 3. It says this is a Shadow Warrior 3 Stan account. Get tickets now. And I just think that's really great. I don't know. It's good. You know. I have a different MVP than Karun. I don't know if your MVP is Karun, Kurtis. But
yep.
I think it's worth giving a shout out to Ben. So Festus's husband, because I do think that without him, Festus wouldn't have come back to the fight, and without him, Icarus would have won. Because it really is like that passion that you get from him, that line where he's like, I've been waiting for so long to clip your wings or whatever it is, that he just really, and he waits until, and his invention is so powerful. Like the thing that he uses to contain Icarus is like so specific, and it really does like allow her to have the time to go do what she needs to do. And I know he gets out of it eventually, but I also just really like that they have this sort of really cute relationship that it really is. I mean, I like that relationship way more than Cersei and Dane. I can't get over it. I'm so angry about how little I care about Cersei's relationships. But so it was nice to have somebody have a really genuine connection with a human. And I know that Kingo and Karun, obviously that's the real like good like human and an eternal relationship, but I think that there was something really beautiful about Ben and Festos as well, and the family that they had, and to be able to bring somebody back from the brink of thinking that humanity is terrible through that thread of like love and family is such a universal theme, and I like that they were able to touch on that, and you didn't have to hammer it home. All you had to see was him living his life and building this house to protect the things that he loved, even though he hated humanity. And I think that that is, there's something really beautiful about that.
Yep.
And it makes him want to save what he otherwise would have wanted to kill. And I think that that's like, I think underestimated, like it took him what, 50 years to go from wanting to hate. Oh, maybe more than that. How long ago since World War II? So long. Anyways.
But, a long time. Yeah. It also makes you sad thinking that he's going to, his husband will continue to age, but he won't.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, that's my throw in, just to be a little bit different.
Do you also like the moment at the end where they take away Sprite's immortality so that the actors can actually age in the next for the next couple of movies?
Which is great. But it also speaks to this sort of the thing that I dislike. Again, you can't have villains in movies without them being punished. And her punishment for going with Icarus is not to die, it's to be exiled, essentially. Like, she's no longer an Eternal.
So that's a normal thing in the comics as well, though. They're exiling people all the time, each other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well. Like, it, but I mean, and she still gets to be obviously part of their family, like she's obviously going with Kingo and all that. Which, by the way, can we have the episode where you have Kingo and Karun and they go back home and Sprite is dealing with some sort of teenage BS and he has to deal with it? Because that episode would be delightful. But yeah, I mean, I think that it does make it nice to be able to continue to tell stories with her, but. Mm-hmm. Also because her power was weird anyways. I don't know. They just seemed so... I don't know, their powers were intriguing. Anyways. Did you say your MVP is Karun? Kurtis? Is that
It was originally going to be, but then when Mike said that was his, I'm gonna change mine to Makari, whom I already talked about.
There you go. That's good. She deserves it.
Yeah.
She's rad. Like I say, she makes me like my real, I will, and we all just know if you follow my Twitter that my real MVPs are Kingo and Druig, but together, because there's so many photos of the two of them on the internet. And I mean, not obviously not Kingo and Druig, but like a, what is it? Barry, however you say his last name.
And Kumail.
On the MGM.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Let's talk about the post-credit scenes. Star Fox and Pip the Troll.
Pip the Troll was the worst animated character in the MCU. It looked absolutely terrible.
It was upsetting. Yeah.
I don't understand how that happened. What happened there, but yeah, it should have been a big moment. Like the whole thing of it should have been a big moment, but Harry Styles is an interesting choice, and I'm gonna go ahead and say that this is evidence that I'll speak for myself that I am getting old, because like I know who Harry Styles is, but I don't care, right? Like it doesn't matter to me that now he's in the MCU. I know that
he's gonna kill it in this role.
Is he gonna be good?
Oh yeah.
They have the same personality. It's good, but it's like, but I know that there are some people that like that are gonna pop for that moment because it's like, oh my god, it's Harry Styles, and it's like cool.
Luckily, I was with somebody that could tell me who it was because I was like, I think that this is a pop star. I think that it's the One Direction dude. Here's the thing that you're right. I think, Mike, that you can speak for all of us, I think, when you age ourselves. But, like, One Direction has four people in it, right? But only two of them we know by name? Because I think I know Harry Styles and then Zayn Malik? I don't know. Sure. Who I confuse with Rami Malik.
None of the Jonas Brothers are in One Direction, right?
I know.
These are different things, right?
That's fair. I know like, that. Right.
What difference does it make? This doesn't matter.
But the significance of the scene, you want to talk about the significance of the scene here?
So I mean, like for me, I think that probably for people of our age, Patton Oswalt as Pip is probably a bigger deal for a lot of us. To finally be in the MCU. I
finally, I mean, he was technically in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. if you call that MCU.
Yeah, I don't. I didn't from day one of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I was like, there's no way that they're going to keep this. I was like,
I still do. It works.
This is fun, but there's no way that this is going to continue to mesh. Actually, I shouldn't say from day one. When they did the Sif episode and I was like, that's what you guys call a crossover? No, they're not. Their heart's not in this. They don't actually care about this thing. And I was very right. By season two, it was like, we're not acknowledging the movies anymore at all. That's a different episode. We don't need to talk about that. Having that character show up is really cool because it ties into like the large. So what this all implies to me is that the next time that we see those Eternals that are on the ship will probably be the post credit scene of Guardians 3. Because Eros and Pip being a character that is so tied to Adam Warlock. Yeah. And Adam Warlock being in the next movie, in the next Guardians movie, and Eros being Thanos' brother and all that. So it's like, we will have a moment where he's like, this excites me. This does really excite me where it's like Gamora is there and Eros is there. And she's like, what? No hug for your uncle. And it's like, well, this is weird. This is weird and confusing and makes no sense, but it's what we're here for. And I love it. And it'll work in Guardians. That character will work in Guardians and they'll put more energy into it. Sure. And all of that stuff will make a lot of sense. And we'll be in a world where we're a little bit more,
can you make it make sense for me? What do you mean? Yeah. You got a hug for your uncle. You're talking about things that I don't understand.
Okay, so who's Star Adam Fox.
So sorry.
Adam Warlock.
Remember, don't hate me.
At the end of Guardians of the Galaxy 2, we saw the race of gold people. The Sovereign. They created this big egg, this huge sarcophagus of a thing. And and then the main gold person says, I'll call him Adam. And so this is a character called Adam Warlock, and he's a known adversary of Thanos and through the comics. And so they're going to have a big to-do. And he's going to appear in Guardians of the Galaxy number 3. Now, this character here, Star Fox, is the brother of Thanos. And they are both Eternals. Star Fox and Thanos, so we will see them come into play at some point together, I'm sure.
And Pip is Adam Warlock's sidekick, basically. Pip the Troll is
The role you see, exactly.
Not Star Fox.
The role you see him here. I think it's going to be good as long as they can like change his character design or something.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's like where it this post credit scene does not work for the general audience in the way that a lot of the other post credit scenes work, and even for some of the more like I don't know how to define it, but like you have to be like a pretty hardcore I read most of the Marvel stuff fan. And definitely have knowledge of like the older stuff because Pip is not a character that's really been in the more modern stuff. Like these are not characters that have shown that references, maybe like a cameo or something in a Guardians comic, but they haven't been, these characters haven't been in play in a long time. So this is one of those ones where
especially Star Fox.
Like Star Fox is back to,
he's not a character for the Me Too era. His whole thing is making people fall in love with him.
There's gonna be a lot of like these characters need to be updated like severely, and having them like sort of in this switched context where Pip is with Eros is another thing that like it threw me off at first because I was like is that like that's Pip, it's Pip.
As soon as Eros, I saw him, I thought we were gonna like, see Warlock.
It felt like we were about to get, and I was like, but that character is going to get introduced in the next thing. And then it didn't happen. And it's like, and I said to Crystal, I was like, that was a setup for Guardians 3, but also like it was a really bad setup for Guardians 3. like it what we needed was something a little bit more concrete, of like something to connect this a little bit more to that, to that world. It didn't quite work. I think in the way that it will work in retrospect once we've seen the next Guardians movie and maybe some of the other stuff that's coming down the pipe. And we'll go, oh, okay, that's how these characters tie into things. Because it's like, bringing Eros in now after Thanos is gone is like a really weird, like, after the fact thing. So obviously they're going to do something completely different with him, right? Like we're going to, it'll be in there, but I think the fact that he's related to Thanos has a lot more to do with Gamora than it does with the Infinity Stones, right? Whereas we're so used to like Thanos, Infinity Stones, what? And it's like, yeah, he's not a threat though. And the last like three or four things that we've seen have been like, hey guys, the Infinity Stones aren't a big deal. Thanos wasn't that big of a deal, right? Like we've really been playing down how much of a threat Thanos actually was to prepare us for whatever the next thing is, right? So it's one of those things of like the name drop of Thanos and having Eros come in. It's like it's a little bit muddled right now. I'm sure that there's good stuff coming down the pipe with this. And I'm excited for Patton Oswalt to play that character. But again, like the CG being so obviously cartoonishly bad, like he looks, he'd be more at home in Who Framed Roger Rabbit than in the MCU with the way that he looked. And it's just, it's just one of those things where you're just like, oh, this is cringy and not in the way that I think they wanted it to be.
It does
portend very good things in our future. So I'm excited, but I'm also just like a little bit like kind of in the moment. Especially cause like we need those, the post-credit scenes in Shang-Chi are so good, right? Of doing the two things of like the one of them being like, hey, Avengers level threat incoming. And then the next one being like, but hey, also the Ten Rings aren't gone. Right. So it's like this one, both of these post-credit scenes, when we get to the one with Dane Whitman and the Ebony Blade, and then the other Ebony Blade, I guess. for those who don't know, Mahershala Ali is the voice that says off screen, are you sure you're ready for that? Or whatever he says.
The other Ebony Blade.
Yes. I intend all of my puns.
Awesome. Wow.
That's so funny. I love it.
There is no way that that didn't occur to everybody who was involved with putting that scene together. Of like, hey, you know what would be a really great time to introduce Blade, the Daywalker, vampire hunter, formerly Wesley Snipes, now Mahershala Ali, with the Ebony Blade. Like, let's do that. That's funny. That's a funny joke.
That's pretty funny.
It's a very good dad joke. But yeah, that one got me so much more excited. But they telegraphed it with. We already knew Dane Whitman, Black Knight. I wasn't paying attention to who he was playing, who Kit Harington was playing going into the movie. So it was a surprise for me in the theater. And then when they name drop King Arthur, I was like, oh, so like we're going like full like Arthurian legend, all of this stuff is coming into play.
Well, it has to with his character.
But it's one of those things where it's like sometimes they introduce a character with a name and you're like, oh, cool. And then it doesn't end up being like that character doesn't end up going into another movie and fully realizing the potential of that character. Right. Maybe we see them one more time and then we never see them again. Right. Like,
yeah, because they need more Avengers. They need more Avengers for their Avengers movies. Yes, so they're not going to waste this one.
Yeah, so but name dropping King Arthur is like, oh, so we're going to explore all of that stuff. It's not just going to be like a, hey, here's a side character who's got a cool sword. It's like there's every potential that like Captain Britain and, you know, like all of these characters could come into play at some point, especially with the mutants coming in soon, and all. It's exciting. It like, cause there's a lot of X-Men implications, Excalibur, Exiles stuff. That's all multiverse. It sends me spiraling out into the Marvel universe, going like, where are we going next? What is happening? And then you go like, by the way, he's teaming up with Blade. Like, okay, the Black Knight and Blade. I'm down for it. It's not what I would have picked for an MCU film, but yeah, certainly not to introduce the character of Blade, the vampire hunter, right? Like that's a weird, it's a very odd pairing, which says to me that they have something really cool planned. Like knowing Kevin Feige and the types of stories that he's set up in the past, for them to be like, the way we're going to introduce Mahershala Ali's Blade is with a post-credit scene in the Eternals with the Black Knight and the Ebony Blade. Like, that's how we're going to do this. That's how we're going to bring this character in. It's like, okay. Like, I'm buckled up and ready for it. But it is one of those ones where it's like, you guys couldn't have put him in a costume so we could just see him in the shadows at least. You know, just a smile with the fangs. Because, like, that is one of the characters that I am the most excited about. For the future, I think that they did it on purpose, like, because some people are like, oh well, maybe they haven't designed the character yet, whatever, they're not that far along. I think they did it on purpose to fuel speculation of like, was that who was, so that in the theater we could be like, who was that? I think that was Blade. I think that was this character. I think, because some people were like, was that Sam Jackson? And I was like, no, that definitely is not Samuel L. Jackson's voice. But
yeah,
There was a lot of like people having conversations and speculating, and I was definitely walking out going, I am almost positive that that was Mahershala Ali, which means that that's Blade, which is a huge deal and like really exciting, because you know some of the rumors is that we might actually see Black Knight and Blade for the first time, like as hero, like Black Knight in costume. And Blade on screen in Moon Knight. That's where we're going to introduce those characters more fully. And we got a sneak peek at Moon Knight in that sizzle reel, by the way. So go, if for anybody who has not watched that sizzle reel yet, and Kurtis, you said you haven't, go.
I've seen that clip though. I've seen the clip.
Whoa. Steve.
Have you seen the clip? Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
I saw it. I feel like I can say that I saw something, because yeah, I did definitely watch it.
Cause that Oscar Isaac, The accent is a choice, but I'm okay with it because it's Oscar and I trust him. It'll work. Insaba didn't work out so well, did it? Everybody's got to have one of those though. So let's hope that he doesn't have two. What we've seen of Moon Knight, I have a lot of faith in that. In that,
it's going to be awesome.
I'm really excited about that one.
Yeah.
And if we do get. If we get Oscar Isaac and Mahershala Ali on screen together playing off each other, I don't know if I'll be able to handle it. Like, I'll probably have a stroke, because that's like, those are probably two of the most underrated best actors of this generation.
Oscar Isaac isn't underrated. Neither of those actors are underrated. They're very highly well rated.
They show up in stuff. Amanda, nobody,
the general public still doesn't know who they are.
Mahershala Ali does not open movies. Oscar Isaac does not open movies. You don't put his name up top like you do with other actors, right? Do critics know who those actors are? 100%. Are they like lauded, and do they get awards? 100%. But it is one of those things of like there's a lot of people who know who Oscar Isaac is. They don't watch his movies. I guarantee it. I guarantee that the majority of the audience, like general public, does not watch A Marriage Story or what was the HBO one?
Oscar
that he did?
Isaac's in A Marriage Story?
No, sorry, not A Marriage Story. Scenes on a Marriage.
That's your...
No, okay, I was just mixing up titles. Scenes on a Marriage, which was just the thing that just happened. What was the thing? He did an HBO series where he's got a terrible mustache in it, but it's fantastic. He has a terrible mustache because it's a period thing, but
whatever, it's okay. It doesn't matter.
I But like most people don't watch the majority of things that he does. They see him in Star Wars and Dune, and they'll see him in Moon Knight, and they know that he's a good actor, but they don't actually watch the stuff where he's a ridiculous, phenomenal actor. In any case, if we got the two of them on screen together, that will be fantastic. So I'm excited about that. Any other comments about that post credit scene? Do you guys have anything else about that one?
Only that it could possibly tie into the Venom 2 post credit scene that I wanted to bring up.
We saw it together actually. So
okay,
we're safe. But if anybody hasn't seen Venom, Let There Be Carnage, and doesn't know what the post credit scene is, you Turn might not want podcast. To get spoiled on this one.
So Venom has big ties to the Celestials. Did you know that? His symbiote is an alien, and it comes from a race of an alien race that the leader of it, his name is Null. And Null is like the embodiment of darkness and the most evil thing in the whole universe. And he has this sword called the All Black that draws power directly from Celestials. and that's where he gets all his power. That's how he's able to create his whole race and stuff. And they are big adversaries. And the All Black is a sword that eventually gets found by this character named Gore the God Butcher, who is being played by Christian Bale in the next Thor movie. So,
I did not even put that together. You're right.
So there's a big Thor connection there. They could be tying the Eternals into a whole big Venom story. So the fact that Venom popped into the MCU at the end of Venom 2 could actually play pretty big in the future of the Eternals.
Wow.
I can't believe you put these puzzle pieces together, because now that you're saying this, it's like you're probably right. This is because we're all thinking that Venom coming into the MCU has something to do with No Way Home. And what if that's a total red herring and it has nothing to do with No Way Home? And it actually has to do with this Eternal stuff and something in Thor Love and Thunder and whatever, you know, other bigger celestial threats are coming.
Also, did you notice when Dane looked at the ebony blade, there was a part of it that was uncovered and it was like moving around?
It was like symbiote stuff.
So yeah. Could the ebony blade be in the Marvel universe, in the cinematic universe, could the ebony blade be All Black, the All Black, and like the same thing?
Because what better way to explain the curse of the ebony blade than actually relating it to Null
the Eternals.
And to the Eternals and to the symbiote, right? Like, because as an audience, as an MCU audience, we know what the symbiote is, even though it hasn't existed in the MCU yet. Now it does, but and what does that mean? And blah blah blah, right? But we do like there is an understanding that like, hey, we're not going to do Spider-Man's origin story again because we know that you guys have seen those movies, right? And again, like, hey, we don't need to redo Venom. You guys have seen the Venom movies. You guys have seen Spider-Man 3, for better or worse, on that one. Not really a great origin story for the symbiote. But you understand what it is. Now, what if we tied this sword to Null and to the Eternals and the Celestials and actually tell you where the symbiote came from? And bring Spider-Man into this. And
there's also a great story where Thor uses the All Black to defeat Galactus. just so you know. Not that they're going to do that, because they'll save that for the Fantastic Four, but, you know.
Yeah, I think the Fantastic Four will probably get that honor, but. Wow. Man, you just, like, see, this is why we love the MCU, right? Like, this is the stuff where it's, like, something so disjointed and disconnected as Venom and the Eternals could now potentially be forever changed and like synonymous for a huge chunk of the audience that never would have put those two things together. That will be a masterstroke, I think, bigger than anything we've seen yet in the MCU. I can't think of anything that they've done so far that has been like that big of a, like, wow, that's a way to tie those things together. Like, that's what a way to bring, like, I would say, like, the Planet Hulk, Thor Ragnarok storyline was definitely one of those ones where it's like, well, that's how you do Planet Hulk when you can't do Planet Hulk. Right. Like we got Gladiator Hulk. We got a lot of that. We got a lot of the pathos of that story and character development for the Hulk and Bruce Banner that we can't get because we can't do Planet Hulk because Universal has the rights and won't play ball, right? So if we can't do that, this is the best that we could do, right? And I would say that's the only thing that's coming to mind right now that, like, comes close to tying that stuff together.
Yeah,
also,
I think
making me like Dane more, because I was very upset with him in this movie.
And so was I.
I was very upset.
He was not.
I was just
well
very upset
all.
That he existed in this movie. Yeah, and and so for one of the biggest flaws, I think, is actually now you're making it, painting it in a good light. Because for me, I feel like this was a vessel for other films, as opposed to being allowed to be a film on its own, just because they crammed so much into it. But if it does lead to this sort of brilliant open world that you're describing and these interconnected storylines, then maybe I can get on board post. Maybe it's one of those films that will get better. You know how sometimes films, like, stories can get better retroactively they really serve something in the future? And so I'm hoping everything that you guys are saying are making me think that maybe that could be
the payoff. The prequels are the Star Wars prequels are a really great example of that, just for people to sort of put that in their frame of reference. It's like, because of the Clone Wars, Star Wars Rebels, and the sequels, there's so much when you go back and watch the prequels that it's like, oh, I never thought about it that way, but now I do because of these other stories that came afterwards. As well as the prequels themselves enhancing the original trilogy in the way that they do. But I do think that in retrospect, we'll look back on the Eternals and go like, okay, now it makes sense why they couldn't do this or couldn't do that. It doesn't. I don't think that it'll forgive the fact that it's a long, boring movie. Right. Like, I think that that'll always be one of those things of like, hey, we're doing an MCU rewatch. Can we skip the Eternals though? Like, can we,
no,
like, I know how important some of this boring stuff is for the overall story, but can we skip it?
So I have a question. What was
the Thor the Dark
the original order of these movies had Eternals coming before Shang-Chi, right?
Yeah.
Like, was this movie supposed to really kind of kick off phase four?
Black Widow was always going to be the next one. That was supposed to be May.
But that always felt like a coda to phase three.
Yeah, in the same way that Iron Man 3 is the first movie after Avengers. And it's like Iron Man 3 is really like an epilogue to the Avengers. Yeah. And then Far From Home was an epilogue to Endgame.
Right.
But Black Widow would have been another epilogue. So, in a weird way of going back to before Endgame. Yeah. Man, that was a bad choice. Just bad choices all around with Black Widow, guys. Guys, bad choices. Yeah. It could have been something way, way better. But anyways. So Eternals was gonna be like the big, like,
the launching point.
We're back. Yeah. And then Shang-Chi would have been next. Because Eternals should have been November of 2020. Right? Yeah, November of 2020, and then Shang-Chi was going to be February of
this year,
and got pushed to September of this year. Yeah. Yep. And a lot of this stuff was supposed to be in place, and like the a lot of the stories what should have been like long past, and then were like Venom, Let There Be Carnage, one of them, and then No Way Home. It's like a ways off after that, but somehow it's like happening back to kind back of in now. The middle of all.
Yeah,
because we're supposed to have gotten Multiverse of Madness this month. Like, think about yes. that fact is that yeah. like we're not getting Doctor Strange until
is it
May
still March
next
is it
year
May now? Oh,
no, it man. Got oh. it got because everything got pushed one spot, right?
Right, right.
So yeah, I think Doctor Strange is May of next year.
What has the March spot? Does anything have March?
Nothing. No? There's nothing. An empty spot. Yeah, it's okay. We lost one slot, and everything shifted forward one.
Right.
But that's okay because we'll have other stuff in there, probably Obi-Wan Kenobi in there to keep everybody busy and not caring about a lack of MCU. But
there won't be. There's still like Moon Knight and She-Hulk and whatever. So
that's yeah, I think some of that stuff's a little further off. I think some of that stuff's a little bit further off. I don't know that we're going to see Moon Knight until probably this time next year.
It would make a good Halloween.
It would be perfect for like October, November. It would be a perfect one for that time of year. Everything's all kind of messed up and funny, but we should have gotten Multiverse of Madness before No Way Home. That was the original plan, but so it'll be interesting to see how like maybe things have shifted and maybe the story for No Way Home will be a little bit different because of those orders changing. Or Doctor Strange just might say some stuff and we might be like, what is he talking about? And we don't know because we haven't seen that movie yet.
Well, it could be that
use it to like enhance the mystery of that movie.
They now have enough time to do some reshoots if they need to like change some dialogue or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure that they've handled it. I'm sure that they're not going to get caught with their pants down on this one. but what do we got? I guess we're into recommended reading now.
Right. Give us the list. The Eternals are characters that don't pop up very often. They just kind of pop up every time Marvel needs to keep their trademark in check. So it's like, the trademark's about to expire. Well, not expire, but like we got to prove that we're still using this trademark. So we got to make these characters again. So, you could check out Eternals by Jack Kirby, the complete collection, which is the entire original run of Eternals. But if you're fans of the movie, it's not actually recommended that you read that because it's not great and it's so different. Instead, I would check out Eternals by Neil Gaiman and John Romita Jr. That's one where they kind of did a really good reboot of the characters and brought them into the modern Marvel universe. And then there's the current series. The first trade is out called Only Death is Eternal, and it's by Kieran Gillen and Asad Ribic. And that one is a good spot. And that trade actually has a good Thanos story in it as well. So all of you Thanos fans can check that one out. It's called Eternals, Only Death is Eternal.
Cool.
That's it.
Awesome. Well, I guess next up, I don't, is Shang-Chi? I guess Shang-Chi. Let's say Shang-Chi for now. Yeah. I have to look at the schedule and see.
I thought we already talked about Shang-Chi, but I think that we just talked about Shang-Chi multiple times.
We got to talk about it eventually. I mean,
we talked about it on Thunderquack a little bit, but we haven't done like.
But we didn't do it enough. Said
the
yeah.
full rundown. Yeah. So.
And it's now there. I've seen it again. I've now seen it like four times. So I am primed to.
Yeah, and I'm gonna watch it a couple more times, I'm sure, before we do, record that one. But we've got Shang-Chi and Hawkeye coming up. Hawkeye starts at the end of the month, so.
And that's exciting. I will say, for as much as people are saying that Eternals is whatever that you're saying, you don't want to rewatch it, I do recommend a rewatch of Eternals because I did get more the second time around. And it's, I don't know. I just think you appreciate things more. And you can, since you know what the movie's about, it
for sure.
it helps.
For sure.
To know what the movie's about.
It's a big investment. So. It's a big investment at what is this, 2 hours and 45 minutes essentially, but
I'll see it when it's on Disney Plus again.
Yeah,
then I can watch it in installments.
Yeah. I would love it if, like, if there's a bunch of stuff on the cutting room floor for this movie, I would love it if they were like, here's an extended edition. Like, if there's potential for a 4-hour cut of the Eternals, Eternals.
I would watch that.
That I would rewatch. Like, if they were like, hey, here's actually all the stuff. Like we heard you guys, you feel like they were light on some of the character development. Well, that's because we cut some of these scenes and here they are. So now, like, here's some scenes with Sprite where you actually care about her character, or here's some stuff with Circe and Icarus that isn't just them holding hands. Or you know, having sex on a really uncomfortable rock. The first time I thought that was sand. Like when the first time we see that in the movie, I was like, oh, sand, that's not that big of a deal. And then when they go back to that place later on in the movie and you're like, oh no, because it's daytime, you're like, oh no, those are rocks, that's not good for your back.
You don't know how soft they are. It's an alien. Oh no, I guess not an alien planet.
No, it's Earth. It's there's no such thing as a soft rock. Rocks are rocks, guys.
Maybe it's a sponge.
You know what? This is not the right kind of speculation for this podcast. So we got to cut it off. That's it. I enjoyed talking
about. You know, our conversation has run out, right?
Yeah, when we're talking about sponge rock.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for listening. I know that I said initially like that I was gonna fill the spot every fourth Monday with episodes of Faster, More Intense with the Star Wars podcast, and we did one, and then we'll just slot Nuff said in it, and I think that probably going forward that's probably what is going to be in that spot. I unless we end up with a gap. In which case we'll do something else, or maybe like if we end up with a gap, I think maybe we need to go back and start with Iron Man. But problems for the future.
They are, and go I just and have it. To say that one of my favorite moments. I'm now on Twitter. It is. I just retweeted it. Like the little shoulder bump that I talked about with Droog and Makari. There's totally a GIF of it, and the Eternals account tweeted it. I just tweeted it at you guys. So enjoy that favorite moment. Thank that will you. Be forever on my Twitter timeline. So good. Come on, there's gems in everything. I love it.
No, there's good stuff in this movie. It's I just don't want to sit through 2 hours and 45 minutes for the 15 minutes of stuff that I really liked. And then the rest of the stuff is fine. It's fine. I was doing the outro. We were almost out.
I'm so sorry. And Amanda just pulled us right back. Do it again. I do.
Yeah. We don't have a sign off for this podcast. That's the real problem. That's the real issue. Is that we have no way of ending the show. There's no way to end the show.
Because we never think about it until this moment.
Yeah.
Every episode. Try to end it and it never works. There you go. You just tell people to keep coming back.
Yeah. It's like this episode is eternal.
Amanda and I will be back next week with a regular episode. Oh, actually, there is something really important for you diehard Thunderquack fans that'll be with us next week. I watch The Matrix. I didn't think about it last week when we recorded Thunderquack, but hey, you guys know who you are. You know what you did. You know who you are. And I'll tell you guys on Discord and on Facebook, by the way, we have a Discord group. I don't know how people find Discord channel. I don't know what server. It's a server, I think, is the nomenclature.
I don't know.
You don't even know what Discord is. I know, Amanda. I haven't. That's why you don't. That's why I haven't talked to you about this, because I'm gonna be like, hey, we have a Discord server, and you're gonna be like, a what? And then I
know what Discord is.
Teach you what Discord is. Okay.
Come on.
But I'll let you guys know over there to watch The Matrix between now and Monday. But Amanda, I'm letting you right now know to watch The Matrix between now and Monday.
I have to watch The Matrix. Oh, bummer.
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine.
We have three episodes of the Thunderquack podcast left before The Matrix Resurrections, which did have a joke that I decided not to go with when in our favorite moments, where my favorite moment was The Matrix Resurrections trailer. Because it was like, that was the moment in the theater that like that popped the most for me. It was like,
I'm not excited about that movie.
Oh really, man? Because yeah. the three times I've seen it when I in the theater with Venom, with Dune, and with Eternals, all of those times is like when it gets to that point in the because the trailer's going with the White Rabbit, like the all of the Alice in Wonderland nonsense or whatever, and it's like, oh, this is cool, I like this vibe. Everybody else is trying to rip it off in their trailers to way less success. But then it gets to that point in the trailer where it really starts to get hype, and the Matrix theme comes in. It's like you get like the boing, and it's just like, oh my god, I get so excited for it, and I'm just gonna douse that excitement, that flame, with the water that is the Matrix sequels over the next month. But we are gonna rewatch through those because I haven't watched I've watched the Matrix within the last few years, but the other two not in a long time, so we are gonna do that on the Thunderquack podcast over the next three episodes, so that's a heads up for everybody. And maybe if you're only listening to the Marvel ones, which would be really weird if you found the Thunderquack podcast because of Nuff
podcast and then just watched Nuff,
and then all you listen to is our Marvel reviews and you have no idea like the dynamic between any of the three of us, and you're just like, but you, because this is, hey, because hey, if you're here for Marvel information, there are better podcasts. But anyways.
Yeah, like mine, the Epic Marvel podcast.
Exactly, exactly.
Well, go listen to Kurtis make sense about Marvel stuff.
Yeah, hey, go listen to Kurtis give you information without Amanda and I arguing over top of him.
That's right.
Yeah.
And being nonsensical and never ending the Eternal podcast. Although, I will say, if you like the Thunderquack podcast, because Mike and I talk about a lot of like important like social issues as well, which we totally didn't talk about in this Eternals podcast with such a diverse cast. And like,
yeah,
and with sign language in the movie and all this, I mean, I'm just kind of like, well, this is not a representation.
And a gay kiss center screen, yeah, in the middle of this,
right,
movie.
Like,
totally.
Come on, we missed. I'm so sorry, and I feel, yeah, so guilty because I watched it with Ryan yesterday from a Riverdale Gang podcast. He's like, make sure you talk about the diversity in this show, and then I didn't, so I've let everybody
tell
down.
Him to talk about it on his own podcast.
Awesome. Well, it's significant. It's cool.
It is awesome.
Yeah. There was a lot of really awesome moments in this. So,
and there was more than one Asian character in the movie. That was quite something.
Yeah.
Yes.
Representation
awesome. Matters.
Awesome. Cool. That's it. We're done. Thank you guys for listening. We'll catch you on the next one.
See you next time.
Bye.
Follow the Thunderquack Podcast on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook by searching the Thunderquack Podcast. You can support us in three ways. First, by heading to the podcast service of your choice and leaving a rating and review. Second, by going to store.thunderquack.com to pick up some merch from your favorite podcasts. And last but not least, by heading to patreon.com/thunderquack to kick in with your monthly pledge of support and get cool rewards like early access and extended episodes. The Thunderquack Podcast is the official podcast of thunderquack.com. Head to thunderquack.com to discover more great podcasts.
Thanks, I hate it.